Right. Good morning, church. Good morning and welcome. It is good to be together. If you find yourself kind of in the middle, if you're able to move to one of the edges of the outside, that way, or towards the middle, I know you got there early to still in the end. If you can move towards the middle, I know we still have folks coming in, so that'll help with seating. But welcome. It is good to be here. My name is Pastor Bryan. What an awesome morning today is. Amen. Been something that God has been working us towards for a while now, and praise the Lord that we are finally together in this space. God is good. There's something special about first. A first birthday, first anniversary. If you can think back to your first car. Maybe you don't want to think about your first car. Your first job, and then the excitement of getting that first paycheck. A first day of school, your first love, the first breakup, first home, the first trip abroad. Maybe you can remember the first pet you ever had. Mine was a hermit crab. It didn't last long. Maybe you remember back to your first loss, where you really experienced grief for the first time. The first birth of a child that you experienced. A first championship by your favorite team. First concert you ever attended. The first we experience in life tell a little bit about our individual stories. They take us back to specific moments in time that we remember forever. Today is an exciting first. So today marks the first time that we gather officially as two congregations committed to the process of joining together in the near future. We will experience a lot of firsts, not just this week, but in the weeks ahead. A lot of firsts will flow out of this experience. First conversations for the kids today, maybe it's the first time in a classroom, a new classroom. First time hearing a new pastor speak, and I could go on. But today as we begin, I would like to call our attention to a special passage of scripture that is a picture of a first. Acts 2, 42 to 47. I invite you to listen as I read this first glimpse of community, the first community of believers. And God's word says this, and they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers. And all came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were being done through the apostles. And all who believed were together, and they had all things in common. And they were selling their possessions and belongings and distributing the proceeds to all as any had need. And day by day, attending the temple together and breaking bread in their homes, they received their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having favor with all the people. I love this part and how this ends. And the Lord added to their number day by day those who were being saved. This is the first glimpse of what biblical community looks like. And as we come together today, yes, this is the first. It's a new experience. But nothing changes. The first believers modeled for us, not perfectly, but effectively, what we are called to do as we begin this new chapter together. They were experiencing many firsts, but God and His Spirit was leading them just as He is today. Do you believe that? I do. And I'm excited that we have the opportunity to worship that God this morning. And so as we begin, we always start with some just family announcements. And now there's kind of a combination of announcements going on. Joan, let me know on the way in that because of the weather this week, they're going to move the senior luncheon to next Tuesday, the 23rd. Again, it's a senior luncheon at Argento's, so just be aware of that. There's a sign-up sheet in the back on the credenza desk there as you enter, and so you could sign up for that, but please talk to Joan if you have any questions about that. Did everybody get, except for our kids, because they'll be dismissed today right before our message, did everyone get a handout today with the fill-in-the-blank and also the sermon series bookmark? If you need one, just raise your hand and Larry will get that for you, or Johnny in the back, anybody on this side, if you need it, awesome. I think we're good. Just one right over here. That's what happens when you got two ushers now. It's nice. We don't miss anything. It's great. Thank you, guys. But we'll be able to utilize those later in our message. Also, just a reminder that there's two offering boxes in the back on either side for the first season here until we officially become one in an organizational sense. There is the BMC offering box in the back, and there's the 242 box on the back, and we won't be passing any offering plates. So if you're a person that gives in a physical way each week, just be aware that those are the two boxes back there. And also, I love the name tags. When I was growing up, we only had one color. Now we got all these cool colors. But we're going to do this for a while because I think it's an important part of this process of getting to know one another. It kind of takes that pressure off. You don't have to ask. And you know, after you ask the first week, sorry, I forgot your name, it gets awkward after that. Now, we just got the go-to name tag, so you can just go right up and say, hey, good morning. And as we come together as a family, putting a name with faces is an important part of that process. And so we'll say more about that at the end of the service. But today, we are going to begin a series in Ephesians, working through the book of Ephesians. And so it starts with a greeting. And I thought, how appropriate that our text today is literally called the greeting as we come together for the first time. And so I am just going to read our scripture reading for this morning, and I ask you to follow on. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, to the saints who are in Ephesus and are faithful in Christ Jesus. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Two verses today that we're going to start with and unpack as we move through the book of Ephesians. But before we begin, I thought we should start by just getting up, greeting one another, and saying good morning to those around you, since we are going to start with a greeting today. All right, let's do it. Let's break. Open this whole thing out.
All right. I hope everyone's getting acquainted. I invite you all to stand if you are able and join us in singing this morning.
Soul, I hear the music ring. storms may come, I am holding on to the rock I cling. How can I keep from singing your praise? How can I ever say enough? How amazing is your I will lift my eyes. I will lift my eyes in the darkest night, for I know my Savior lives. And I will walk with you, knowing you'll see. I can sing in the troubled times, sing when I win. I can sing when I lose my step and fall down again. I can sing 'cause you pick me up, sing 'cause you're there. I can sing when you hear me, Lord, to you in prayer. I can sing with my last breath, sing, for I know that I'll sing with the angels and the saints around the throne. How can I keep from singing your praise? How can I ever say enough? How amazing is your love? How can I keep from shouting your name? I know I am loved by the King, and it makes my heart. I am loved by the King, and it makes my heart. By the King, and it makes my heart wanna sing.
Darkness, we were waiting without hope and without light. Till from heaven you came running, there was mercy in your eyes to fulfill the law and prophets. To a virgin came the word, from a throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise reveal the kingdom coming, and to reconcile the lost, to redeem the whole creation. You did not despise the cross, for even in your suffering, you saw to the other side. Knowing this was our salvation, Jesus, for our sake you died.
Just a moment, Bob Lewis is going to come and lead us in congregational prayer. But before I do that, one of the things that I'm excited about as we come together as two congregations is I always say that the what a church is passionate about comes from the passions of the people of that church. And so as we begin to come together, it's going to be neat to see the different ways that BMC has functioned in the area of missions and outreach. And then the same for 242 and how we get, do giving, what we give to, and all of those things. And one of the things that we at 242 do each year is the last week of the year, we take all the money that comes in. So this year, it was December 25th through December 31st, the last week. And we call it Generosity Week. And any money that comes in, we take and we pray through what organizations we want to give to and partner with. And this year, we gave to three organizations. They're, you can see their logo, it's kind of hard to maybe see. One is a church in Honduras that we partner with, that Wilhelm, who was just up here playing the drums, that's his home church, and an area where we have taken a mission trip to. We also did Called to Peace Ministries, which is a ministry that focuses on equipping the church and also helping survivors of domestic abuse. And then also Genesis Women's Clinic, which I know many of you have a passion for. At BMC, those were the three organizations that we just prayed through, and said, this is who we want to support this year. And so it's always neat how God, in his different ways, it's always the biggest offering of the year. And every year it looks a little different, but I'm excited this Sunday to announce the grand total that came in during the last week of the year. So, Doug, if we can hit that next slide, $18,585.75 came in. Can we just give the Lord a hand of applause? Amen. Glory to God for his just stirring in people's hearts and when to give and how to give and how much to give. And every gift makes it come to that amount. And so we just want to praise the Lord for that. So if you do the math on that, we have the opportunity to give $6,200 to each ministry. And just a way to bless them as a local church and really continue to keep before us that we want to impact our community with missions, but we also want to reach the ends of the earth. Wilhelm, I just want to share real quick. You can stand. I know this is no good for live stream, but real quick, last week, I wanted to share with, and I said, we need to get on Zoom and share with Pastor, okay? Anybody want to guess what Pastor is in Spanish? Pastor, okay? That's my Spanish skills, okay? And I said, hey, we need to get on this week and share what God brought in. And I didn't tell them out, but I said, hey, they started talking about, they were just over there, Rachel and Wilhelm, and I said, what's the project that you think he'll want to use it for? Because I was just there. And he said, they really want to increase an education classroom to teach people. And I said, that's awesome. I said, how much do you think it's going to be? Wilhelm, stand up and tell everybody how much you said to me real loud. All right, how much?
$6,000.
$6,000. Think about that for a sec. Okay? Literally, I didn't tell them out, and I just like got this like big grin on my face and said, well, you're going to have a couple $100 to spare. And praise the Lord. Isn't that neat how the Lord works ahead of us? And when we're generous, he knows where we need to give, and he just does the work from there. And so we're really excited and thankful and plan on continue to do that in the future. God is good. So, Bob, would you come up and just lead us in prayer, please?
Let's pray. God, you are such a good God. God, you are a very generous God. And God, I thank you for the obedience of the church body and just giving towards you, just trying to give back a little portion of how generous you've been to us. God, it's amazing how you already had the plans of what this money was going to go to, as we heard this morning from Wilhelm's church. And Lord, I know the other ministries will be blessed in a special way as well. And God, you deserve all the praise and glory for that. God, we just thank you for that. And we just, as we go into this new year, we just ask that we would have that continuous, generous heart and mind, and with our time, talent, and treasures and all that we do. Lord, I just thank you for what you're doing in both bodies, and as we look towards the anticipation of becoming one, Lord, just help us to all have that generous heart with the open palm mentality, Lord. We ask in your name. Amen. I'll ask the music team to make their way up. And just one last piece of announcement. If you're planning to do your taxes this year, which hopefully you are, 242, you should have received an email for your online giving. And if you didn't, let us know and we'll help you get that lined up so you can get that printed out.
All right, I'm going to ask you one more time to stand if you're able and join us in song. We're going to have a scripture reading instead.
Well, you're in the right position. From Revelation chapter 2, verses 1 to 7. To the angel of the church in Ephesus write, the words of him who holds the seven stars in his right hand, who walks among the seven golden lampstands. I know your works, your toil, and your patient endurance, and how you cannot bear with those who are evil, but have tested those who call themselves apostles and are not, and found them to be false. I know you are enduring patiently and bearing up for my name's sake, and you have not grown weary. But I have this against you, that you have abandoned the love that you had at first. Remember, therefore, from where you have fallen, repent, and do the works you did at first. If not, I will come to you and remove your lampstand from its place unless you repent. Yet this you have. You hate the works of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To the one who conquers, I will grant to eat of the tree of life, which is in the paradise of God.
I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, and I will sing of the goodness of God. So good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. Darkest night, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father, I've known you as a friend, and I have lived in the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful.
You may be seated.
All right, gather right around. Ow, that, wow, that's bright. Okay. All right. Awesome. Shiloh, come on over. All right, one of the things we forget in the process of everything happening on is that all of our children are perceiving everything that's been happening. Brody, come over here. Okay, there we go. And that's really cool. Okay. Are kind of going through the different emotions and feelings as they go through this process. And today's going to be kind of a mark of something new for them. And so before you all go to your different locations, I wanted to just stop and pray over all of you. Okay? So let's just go to the Lord, and I want to pray for all of you this morning. Father, we thank you for today. Thank you for this group. God, thank you for the way that you're working in each of their lives. God, we ask that you continue to do that. God, may we be good stewards of the next generation. God, protect them from the evil one. Walk before them, Father. We thank you for all those this morning that and the weeks ahead that work with our kids, whether it's teaching, whether they're in the nursery right now or preschool. God, thank you for the opportunity that we have to teach the Word of God to these boys and girls. Bless them, Father, we ask. In your name, amen. All right, you guys can slowly walk and make your way to the back, all right? There you go. Hey, Abe. All right, I invite the rest of you, if you have a copy of God's Word, to turn with me to Ephesians chapter 1. Ephesians chapter 1. I preach out of the ESV, just as kind of a general announcement, something I have to consider. That is the version of the verses that you'll see up on the screen. So just depending on what version, we have different people that use different versions, but just so you know, that is the version of Scripture that I will be preaching out of. Before we begin and get in the Word this morning, I want to introduce you to someone on the screen. Everybody say good morning, Miss Hetty. All right, so this is Miss Green, okay? Miss Green, okay, I don't know if any of you have ever known about her, but for many years, Hetty Green was called America's greatest miser. It's not a nice definition. When she died in 1916, she left an estate valued at $100 million, an especially vast fortune for that day. I would argue that's still a vast fortune, okay? But she was so miserly that she ate cold oatmeal every morning in order to save the expense of heating the water. When her son had a severe leg injury, she took so long trying to find a free clinic to treat him that his leg had to be amputated because of advanced infection. It had been said that she hastened her own death by bringing on a fit and a seizure while arguing the merits of skim milk because it was cheaper than whole milk. That's a sad tale. And it's a sad tale because Miss Green was given so many resources. God had blessed her. She was a business owner, did a lot of different things, but she didn't access the riches that she had been given. The immense wealth and resources she possessed were left useless and meaningless. Today, as we begin the book of Ephesians, my prayer is that we, as a church family, will be reminded and, if needed, rejuvenated in our faith because of the great resources we have been given by Christ Jesus. Sadly, I believe many Christians often live spiritually malnourished lives because we fail to see and then access the immense blessings found in Christ Jesus. The view of who they are in Christ is weak, anemic. So before we go any further, I want us just to pause, okay? And reflect on Ephesians 1, verse 3. Today we're going to be in verses 1 to 2 of the greeting, but the first verse after that, which we will come to next week, is Ephesians 1, 3. And it says this, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places." You know what that verse means? Quite simply, To be a Christian is to have access to God's portfolio. And not just financially, that's not what we mean. It's God's vast, innumerable, immeasurable resources become our resources. God's riches, his assets, our inheritance is secure. And a word that we're going to see throughout the study is this idea of being full, fullness in Christ. And it's that idea of we are activating, experiencing, and engaging with the blessings of God in the heavenly places. But it's an interesting phrase there, heavenly blessings. Heavenly blessings. And this is what's so hard for us to kind of sometimes understand. Because we live in the physical world as physical beings, it means that we are living with heavenly blessings now. It's not something that we get later when we get to heaven. It's something right now, right here, that we experience through Jesus Christ. And that's going to be Paul's message to these believers, is that, listen, you have access to heavenly blessings now. And so before we go any further, I just want us to take a moment where we are. It's a great time when you start a new series. I want you, before the Lord, just to pause. Bow your head and say, God, I want to, as we study this series, okay, I want to commit to being engaged with these verses and these messages, but I want to ask you something very specific, Lord. I want you to reveal to me and help me greater understand what heavenly blessings look like in my life right now. I think it's an important thing for us to kind of unpack as we go through this series. And so I ask you just to bow your heads, and then I will lead us in prayer before we begin. Father, as we begin this series, God, I pray that you would walk before us. It's a beautiful thing being in a room like this because we know that there's a lot going on. We're all experiencing different things that life throws at us. And yet, this verse reminds us, this study is going to remind us, that we experience heavenly blessings now and that they're directly attached to our understanding of who you are. And so, God, give us a fresh perspective. Do a work and lives. God, let us be vulnerable before you to open ourselves up to your leading, Father. In your name, amen. Whenever you come to an epistle, there's a different message for each church. And sorry for interrupting the song, but I really needed Jim to read this because part of my first point here in my message is to go back and look at Revelation 1:7. So before we get into our greeting, I just want to quickly put those verses back up. Jim just read them for us, so we're not going to reread them. But what's interesting about these verses in Revelation chapter 2, verses 1 to 7, is this is now a letter, but it's 30 years later than Paul's letter in Ephesus. And you know who this letter is written by? It's written by Jesus himself. In Revelation, to the seven churches, he's going to write in Asia Minor, John's going to say, this is a message from Jesus. There's not really many other places in Scripture that I'm aware of where Jesus himself, after he is resurrected in heaven, is going to send a message back to the churches. Most of the epistles are written by the different apostles and disciples. But this, in Revelation 2, is a letter from Jesus through the inspiration of the apostle John on the island of Patmos. And what I love about this is Jesus, you can tell that he really is intimately aware of what's going on in Ephesus. And so we saw that there's the positives. Verse 2, it says, I know your deeds, your hard work, and your perseverance. I know that you cannot tolerate wicked people. And you have tested those who claim to be apostles. That'll be important in a little bit. They're testing those who are coming and speaking truth. So that they're doing their due diligence in this. But then it gets to verse 4. Again, these are the words of Jesus in a resurrected body at the right hand of the Father. But he says, but I have this against you, that you have abandoned the love you had at first. Remember, therefore, from where you have fallen. Repent and do the works where you did at first. If not, I will come to you and remove your lampstand from its place, unless you repent. As we go through the book of Ephesians, we're going to be reminded of what Jesus' words mean 30 years later. But these verses are about legacy. Ephesus was a church with divided affections. Divided affections. Revelation tells us this. They had a high regard for doctrine and truth, but at the same time, they were getting caught up in the momentum of cultural conformity. Can any of us say that that's a real thing? Okay, right? That's part of being a Christian, is this idea that we have divided affections. They had in high regard for doctrine, but they were caught up in cultural conformity. Ephesus, a church that will experience early success, but then as time goes on, they will fade away due to their lack of love for the Lord. They've abandoned their first love. Just want to pause right here and just say it's a great reminder that Jesus, still sitting at the throne of his, right next to the throne of his Father, at the right hand of the Father, he cares deeply how we, as a local church, do church. And there's really only one reason for this. Because it directly affects how we represent Jesus to the world. That's why. Jesus is aware of our existence. You know that this morning? Jesus is aware of our existence. He's aware that we are here gathering in his name. And he desires and cares deeply that we stay faithful to himself. Every one of the churches in Asia Minor, the seven churches that Jesus writes to through John, are in this like struggle, this epic struggle. And it's between two things. Number one is compromise. The idea of compromise is to make concessions, slow, steady concessions for truth. So they have that going on, but then they're also battling the idea of being faithful to truth, faithful to what Jesus taught. And it's hard work. They're trying to figure it all out. In the case of the Ephesians, there's this idea of Jew and Gentile now worshiping under the same roof, which if you study that, there's just a lot there, and it was challenging and hard and difficult. But they have this choice. So before we go, it's just two verses today, so we're going to just do a little contextual work. And I want to put this picture of a stadium up, okay? How many of you have ever gone to a Philadelphia Sixers or Flyers game in what is called the Wells Fargo Center? Anybody ever been there? Okay. The capacity for the Wells Fargo Center is 21,000 people, okay? This stadium in Ephesus held 20,000 people. So what I often do, and this, I don't know why I do, I got to get over this bad habit, but I often go into these epistles and I start reading, and for some reason I classify like, okay, they're just this ancient group of people that, okay, we're going to have to figure out the differences because times were different back then and they looked at it, studied it. But when you start actually studying the things that are on the ground in Ephesus, you realize that, now, there's a lot more of the same than there are differences between our time and their time. Ephesians is a New Testament letter or epistle. 21 of the 27 books in the New Testament are this genre. It's a letter to deep people, but the epistles are often like this. This is why we struggle with it. Everybody picture an onion with me, all right? Don't get teary-eyed, okay? Picture an onion, cut it in half, okay? There is layer upon layer in an onion. Oftentimes when you read, especially the Pauline epistles, you start reading, and then there's like a layer. And then you got to unpack another layer. And sometimes it gets really frustrating and hard to read because you're like, man, there's so many layers. How do I understand? And there's deep theological meaning going on as you move through an epistle. Sometimes you feel like it connects directly with your life when it talks about certain things. And then other times you're like, I'm not really sure. What is that meat? Like eating meat offered to idols? Like what are they talking about there? There's different things that you're going to experience as you go through this. You're going to come across tough words like propitiation and predestination. It's not a narrative. We just finished Nehemiah. It's nice to read Nehemiah. You just kind of go through the story. But when you get to some of these epistles, it's like, man, I'm trying to put this all together here. It's tough. Which is why, everybody hold up your bookmark. Let me say it. Because you said you got one. Okay, good. Thank you. You got your bookmark. Listen, going through Ephesians is going to take some spiritual sweat. It's going to take some spiritual sweat, which is why every date that's on there, you got no excuse to know what's not coming up. The dates, I realize we missed some dates. Those are standalone weeks, okay? We're not messed up the calendar, okay? But as you go through this, I invite you to read the passage once, twice, if you want to do it more, before you get here. Because just let me tell you, reading it once or twice will incredibly help you come into and be aware of what's going on. We need to do that work. Because it's not about you just coming here to hear me talk. That's nothing. That's meaningless. It's you partnering with the Holy Spirit to do the due diligence of preparing to walk through a passage of Scripture. There's a pattern in the epistles. Teaching on doctrine, application of doctrine. Teaching on doctrine. So in Ephesians chapters 1 to 3, it's going to teach about doctrine, specifically Christology, Christ. Verses chapters 4 to 6 is going to be on the application. What does it look like in the church to live like Christ? So you're going to see that pattern. Ephesus was a major city in the powerful Roman Empire, similar to the life in our Western cities today. Full of wealth and fleshly indulgences. Very common in this area. Paul penned this letter between 60 and 62 AD from Rome under house arrest. And something else of note, ladies, you might be interested in this. This was a major shopping hub. Okay? Like the Ephesus premium outlets would have been a real thing in this day, and I kid you not. The shopping there was amazing, and people from all around the world. So consumerism was a major factor and something that really had to be wrestled through for Christians because there was that constant, that pull. Does that feel like anything like maybe today that we're experiencing? There's all these different amazing things and indulgences that we have flown at us all day long as we scroll and we scroll and we scroll. So as we jump into this greeting today, as Paul, through the power of the Holy Spirit, writes this letter. These are the streets, stadiums like this. They also had the Temple of Artemis there. That was one of the seven wonders of the world. These are the things that Paul was, like, these are the places he was hanging out. Like, monster stadiums full of all kinds of sporting and theater and all kinds of things. Competing ideas, different philosophies, political pressures. All of these things were going on. And that context matters as he pens this greeting. So let's look briefly at this greeting this morning. It's only a few lines, but these are often what I call flyover verses, right? We kind of just, we're getting into a book, we just skip the greeting because it's like, yeah, I get it. It's Paul, he's writing to the Ephesians, blah, blah, blah. But here we go. Number one, what's going on? An apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God. What we have going on here is authorship, authentication. And this is important because even in the first years after Jesus, people were beginning to write with authority as apostles and other people that were not actually apostles at all. Satan's good at that. He already has voices coming in that are confusing these early Christians. And so Paul is just saying, I am an apostle of Jesus. It's me. It's the one I spent 2 years and 3 months with you. As an apostle of Jesus, I'm here. I'm speaking with the authority of God. Last week, my Facebook Messenger, I got a message from my Aunt Kathy, except something was fishy, okay? It wasn't Aunt Kathy. I kind of thought it was. There was, like, things that she would say, but then it was just a scammer, okay? This happens all the time, actually, for us, is there's different scams because we live in a digital world, but there's no difference in this time. There was a lot of people that spoke on behalf to say, I was with Jesus, and this is a message I have for you, and people had to be like, whoa, how do we figure this out? Who is it? Paul is establishing his authority, and then we got to do this today. One of the great movements of our time, in our culture right now, everybody say the word NAR, okay? NAR. It's a fun word to say, NAR. It actually stands for New Apostolic Reformation. Right now, in the United States and abroad, there's this massive movement called the New Apostolic Reformation. And what it is it's this idea that God is in a special time where he's giving new revelation, and there's now new apostles walking the earth that have divine special revelation that they can speak on behalf of God. Isn't it fascinating that the same things that they were struggling with in Ephesus, today we battle, because a lot of it sounds really good. There's a lot of theology in it that you're like, oh, yeah, that sounds right. But then all of a sudden they'll say, well, God told me this. And it doesn't line up with Scripture, but it sounds like it does. But a lot of major churches and a lot of major voices that you will come across on podcasts, on YouTube channels, on the radio even, are part of this movement of we are apostles. And we have the ability to speak new revelation and new truth. And it is causing great damage and confusion. Paul was one of the, there was a lot of apostles in this time, because apostle simply means sent one. Like we would look at a missionary. Sent one, going out to speak truth. But Paul met the requirements of 1 Corinthians 9:1, where he was an actual apostle, one of the original, it wasn't the original 12, but there was the 12, and then Matthias, who replaced Judas, and then Paul. And you can study that more in 1 Corinthians 9:1. But then I love this, by the will of God, Paul had all the academic training of his day. studied under the greatest rabbis. Paul would have had the Torah memorized. He was a brilliant communicator, training at the highest level, but this is not what he claims gave him the authority. Isn't that interesting? That's not what he said, like, hey, because of my cred, all right? Like, he would have been at every Ivy League school. He would have been able to get in. That's not what he claims. He claims that by the will of God, he's recognized that God has done a work. It's his knowledge. And when he meets Jesus on the road to Damascus, all that other knowledge is important because God's going to use it. But his knowledge of Jesus Christ is what makes him the Apostle Paul and a missionary. And that's what authority he speaks with. Number two, we see the audience. To the saints who are at Ephesus and who are faithful in Christ Jesus. It seems redundant in a way because you have saints and faithful. Aren't they the same thing? Well, I've kind of heard it taught this way, and it thought it was interesting, that from the perspective of God, I hope you know this, but every Christian is a saint. A saint simply means to be set apart. A saint is not some special class of people who have lived virtuous, righteous lives. And so they get put in a special class, the Hall of Fame, the saints, you know. No, every believer is a saint, set apart by God. And so Paul's just recognizing, like, a saint is the idea of, hey, being holy and being set apart. And that's God's view of who we are. And then the question is, who are faithful? It's that ongoing act of, yes, by faith you are saved. But then the ongoing working out of your salvation is faithfulness to God. No doubt, Paul, many of the people that were there when he was there for those 2 years were probably gone. They had left. They had walked away from the faith. They were no longer going to the church in Ephesus. And he's aware of that. So Paul just says, to those who are faithful. A church is going to experience that over time. It's a sobering thing that many, maybe many in this room, will sit in this room, and over the years, there may come a time when whatever happens in life, they walk away from the things of the Lord. That's a sobering thing. Who are faithful? Next, we see the blessing. Look at verse 2. Just a few words there. It says, grace to you and peace. This was a very normal, common greeting among Christians during this time. We don't really have special Christian greetings anymore. Our greeting is, hey, how are you doing? Good morning. How's it going? What's up? You know, we had like these typical greetings. In this time, there was this special greetings that Christians had for one another that was very much an identity thing. So grace, it's that word charis, which simply means undeserving. I love that. For by grace or charis are you saved through faith, and it's not of yourselves. It's like they included that in their greeting. Wouldn't that be cool if we kind of like utilize that more often as a great reminder? Like on a Sunday, like Larry comes up and says, hey, how you doing? And I just use the word like undeserving. And that'd be like a cool, because it's a great reminder of like, I'm living under grace today. It's a grace. So grace and then peace, which peace flows downstream of grace. It's that idea of shalom, wholeness, spiritual prosperity and completeness. And I remind us, friends, that's the same blessing for us today. How many times this week, how many times even today, did you take time to recognize that you are undeserving and therefore under grace? And as a direct result of that, you have peace. You live under an umbrella of grace, and everything flows out of that. And there's that unsurpassing peace that we just don't understand. I think some of my most miserable weeks that I have is when I flip a switch and I go from having the mindset that I'm undeserving to I am deserving. Can anybody say amen to that? Some of my most miserable weeks are when something inside of me changes and I go, I'm deserving this week. I deserve an easy week. I deserve for my kids to behave this week. I deserve that my wife meets my needs this week. And it's miserable. Because as soon as we switch that from we're under grace to we deserve grace, everything just falls apart. When we get in the mode of I deserve and we forget about grace, we then quickly lose the source of all spiritual blessings. And that's the last part of this greeting. Verse 2, part B, it says, from our God and Father and the Lord Jesus Christ, grace and peace comes from only one place, and we can have peace because we have grace. The more we live in this reality, the more peace we will experience, even when life is hard. And I know life can be very, very challenging. So I come to the conclusion. There's a tagline in our Ephesians logo you might see on your paper that has an idea of, you can see it up in the right corner, it says, "We are family." And I thought that was appropriate as we come together as two congregations. So as we go through this, I want to just kind of bring us and rally us around some things as we close out. So what does this greeting teach us about this idea of oneness and family in the body of Christ? Number one is the language that's used is the same language we could share with one another today. This greeting by Paul could be a greeting used to us today on the top of the hill here on 275 Mill Street. Isn't that cool? The same language, grace and peace to you, to the saints who are faithful. So we have this shared language that we get to communicate around. It's what brings us together. If you can't communicate, it's tough. But then we have a shared responsibility. I go back to Revelation 2. Nowhere in Revelation and nowhere in Ephesians is it going to talk about one person. It's not going to talk about Frank. It's not going to talk about Amanda. It's not going to talk about Melissa. You guys like how I'm picking on everybody on this side? I just did it, right? I'm left-handed, so that's a little hint. I always go to the left, okay? We have name tags, too. That's easier now. We have this shared responsibility. That as God places us here, how bright is that light? And it's not me. It's not you. It's not an individual thing. It's us collectively together. To the saints that are at Ephesus. And then I leave you with this encouragement. We have a shared blessing. We have access to heavenly storehouses. May we not live each day as if we have nothing when we have everything. May we not be miserly in our spiritual walk. Because here's the fact, when you are weak, he is what? When you are down, he lifts you up. When you can't, he can. Because we have the heavenly blessings now on earth. Going to invite our music team to come up to lead us. And I think a very appropriate song. So hard as we live here now to grasp what heavenly blessings are. It's just so hard because we're just inundated with the here and now. And yet that verse calls us to meditate on the fact that we've been giving every heavenly blessing. And so I love the lines of this song. It says, "Above all powers, above all kings." That's the God that we have. Amen? That's where we receive spiritual blessing. So if you're able, I invite you to stand. Let's sing this song together. And then I'll come up and close the service after that.
Above all powers, above all kings, above all nature and all created things, above all wisdom and all the ways of man, you were here before the world began. Above all kings, took the fall and thought of me crucified.
For the foreseeable future, we're going to end every service with just a little family focus, okay? As we come together, I think it's important just to kind of close out in a casual way, just some general introductions of different people. So each week, we're going to kind of share some of the different introductions as we go through this. And then, I believe prayer is the great unifier, okay? God has brought us so far in such a quick amount of time, but also know that Satan hates that. And so I just want to continue to end each service each week with praying together as two congregations that God would protect us from the evil one and pray for one another. So what I wanted to do just briefly is introduce the BMC leadership team, okay? And I'm just going to have them stand. I'm going to say their name because I want to put some faces with some of the key folks. And then each week we're kind of introduced different groups of people in both churches specifically that are in leadership. And so in the back... back there is the council chair who's on leadership. That's Doug Kern. So, Doug, you can wave. You can stay standing. Over here, we have Melissa Parrish, who has served as a deaconess on the leadership team. Also, I don't think Barb is here today. Barb Sanchez, her husband had surgery, so be praying for Barb and her husband. But Barb has also served on the leadership team. And then over here in the back left is Lee. Everybody say hi, Lee. Okay, Lee has served as an elder on the leadership team. And so that is the group that has been meeting with us as an elder team as we've gone through this process. And they have just been a blessing to get to know. And they are passionate and love this church and are very excited about what God is doing here. So thank you. You all may be seated. And then I wanted to introduce the members of the 242 elder team. As we've kind of come together, we lead with an elder team, and so I think they're all in here. So Jeff Durstein, okay, if there's Jeff, Larry is right here, and then Bob is in the back, who led us in prayer earlier. Those and myself are the elder team. Okay, so everybody good? You guys can't forget any names now. You know all the leaders involved. The name tags do help. To close out our service, just a couple reminders. The next 3 weeks, okay, we're going to do, for those that want to, and I would love for everybody to do it, we're going to do a pictorial directory. So in the gym, before and after the service, we're just going to do, this will be a temporary one, okay? So it's not like going to be super professional. We're not having like some super like amazing camera guy come in, okay? It's just going to be a way for us to begin praying for one another. I think that is absolutely vital. But then also as we integrate into ministries and different things going on, it is going to help to know, like, okay, so I'm having so-and-so over to my house. Like, can I actually know what they look like? It's always a nice thing, you know? Like, who are you, okay? And so we're going to do, that is going to be something that over the next few weeks, and then also the email system that we're using, we're going to begin to integrate that. So right now there's two separate emails. BMC, you guys have an email that goes out each week with announcements and different things going on. We also do that on Thursdays. It's called the weekly update. It is, Doug is going to be back there the next few weeks with his laptop, okay? And we have a link that we will send to you, but if it's like a little overwhelming of like, hey, how do I do this form and everything, it's a simple way that you just get your name and email, and it'll go into our system so that then we can integrate you into our communication. So it's snowing. How cool is that? I just saw it out of my eyes. I was like, what is that white stuff coming out? Okay. So how beautiful. And so we're going to do that as just a way. So to close our service today, I'm going to have Alex Long, if you would come up, brother, and lead us in prayer. And then Doug, you can come up right after him and close our service in prayer. Thank you.
Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for what you have brought all of us through, all of our families, our histories, our ancestries. Thank you, Father, for this day that you've brought us to. I think of the 242 story, Lord, how you called us from our sending church in East Greenville to Butter Valley and then to Behind the Grill Shop and to this day here at this church. Father, we thank you for your hand of provision and your guidance, Lord, and for Boyertown Mennonite Church as well, Lord, for their remarkable 240-plus year history, Father, for all that you have led families and the congregation through, Father. Your hand of provision and leading throughout church history, your church, Father, over the past 2,000-plus years is just amazing, Father. Your leading, your provision, your guiding. We can't predict what tomorrow looks like, but we know that you hold it in your hands, Father. I'm reminded of my days of at Christopher Dock, the hymn that we used to sing, "What is this place where we are meeting? Only the house, the earth, its floor. But it becomes a body that lives when we are gathered here and know our God is near." We know that you are near to us, Father. We know that you surround us. When two or three are gathered, there you are as well, as Jesus tells us. Use us, Lord, as your hands and feet in Boyertown, in Pennsylvania, wherever it is that we may go. Lord, thank you for your hand of provision and guidance. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Father God, we just praise you for all that you have done in our lives. You are faithful, Lord. You have our lives planned out. We thank you for this wonderful weather. And we pray for those who need help now for their safety. But more than that, Lord, we just thank you for this coming together, this first service of what we hope you have planned to be many as we grow our churches together into one unified body of Christ. We thank you for all the hard work that the leadership teams have put in over the weeks leading up to this date. We thank you for all those who have contributed, put in sweat and effort to move all the items from 242's previous home to this one. We just ask that you bless us all with patience and grace, with a sense of welcoming each other, getting to know each other, and adjusting to all the changes that we may encounter. Help us to keep our eyes fixed on you, Lord. For this is your plan, and we give all of our anxiety and our concerns to you, Lord. You are good every day. Thank you for all that you do, Lord. Help us to love each other and to take this love and peace that we have today and take it out with us as we leave from this place. We ask for safe travel home and that we may touch others as we go throughout our week. Bring us back here next week as we continue to receive your blessing and bless those around us. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.